being here. Before we get started into the rest of our service for the next hour, I want to do a little bit of a warm-up. I go to baseball games, and I see baseball players. They play every day, and yet they're stretching, they're warming up, and they're doing things to get ready for the main event, and they do it day after day after day, and it occurred to me that sometimes that I need a little bit of a warm-up. So what happened was I was walking and praying, and I was thinking about things in my life that I would like perhaps to be different. Yeah. And the way I want to be different, I say, God, I want a touch from you. I want you to touch me, oh God. So I was thinking about that, and I said, you know, you've touched the person that was blind. You touched the person that was in need of healing. You touched this person. You touched that person. I know that you touch people, and I'd like a touch from you today. So as I was praying this, I was going through this prayer, I said, you know, you touched the woman with the issue of blood. And then I stopped, and I said, no, that's not true. It's not true. The woman with the issue of blood touched Jesus. Here's how this happened. A large crowd was following after Jesus and pressed around him. And a woman was there who had been subject to bleeding for 12 years. She had suffered a great deal under the care of many doctors and yet had spent all that she had. Yet instead of getting better, she grew worse. She got sicker than getting better. When she heard about Jesus, she came up behind him in the crowd and she touched his cloak because she thought, if I touch his clothes, I will be healed. Immediately her bleeding stopped and she felt in her body that she was freed from her suffering. At once Jesus realized that power had left him and he turned around in the crowd and he said, who touched my clothes? You see the people crowding against you, his disciples said, and you ask, who touched me? There's hundreds upon hundreds of people there. But Jesus kept looking around. He kept looking around to see who perhaps did that. And then the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came and fell at his feet and, trembling with fear, told him the whole truth. She told him everything, this personal thing that was going on in her life. She had exposed that in front of everybody. But you know why she trembled in fear? She trembled in fear because in this time, in this culture, a woman touching a man was a death sentence. And yet she exposed what she had done because she knew that Jesus knew anyhow. He said to her, daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace and be freed from your suffering. You see, today, when I heard that, I began to reach out to touch Jesus. And you say, well, John, how do you do that? The way you do it is the way this woman did it. How did she do it? She did it in faith. You see, so I pray and I close my eyes and I think to myself, what's ever on my heart, what's ever on my mind, what's ever going on in my life that I wanted a touch from God from, I'm going to reach out, I'm going to touch Jesus. And you know what? Jesus honors that. God honors that. And to see that happening right in front of my eyes, I had to bring it to you. I had to bring it to you and had to share with you because we all can do that same thing. We can reach out and we can touch Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this worship time this morning. I thank you, Lord, for the baptism of little Kaylee that we're going to be having in just a little bit. And for her family being here and her friends, and I thank you for all of them for being with us today. So, Father, I pray for what's going on here, and I pray for what's happening up at Hope Community Church today. And I pray, Lord, that Wayne will really just work through your Spirit, and great and mighty things are going to be happening. So, Father, thank you for calling us to this place today. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Hey, if you guys are able to sing a couple more songs, would you stand with us if you're able to stand?
I've got time to find it. May the word Thank you.
Family members and friends for being here today for Kaylee's baptism. When I first talked to her mom and I asked what the little girl's name was, they said Kaylee, and I said, I love that name, and then she said that her two children here named her. And I thought, that's really cool, isn't it? Say yes? Yeah, it's nice, yeah. Wow, that's awesome. So we're going to have a few announcements. We're going to go into the baptism and go on with the worship. One of the announcements that I want to make clear is that each year we send young people to camp. And there's brochure downstairs in the Welcome Center. When you go down the steps and you walk straight ahead, you'll see the a desk there. And there's brochures there. And what we do is we pay the amount of the base camp, which is very, very nice. It's a very nice gift. But the people, when you register, you have to pay $50 registration fee. Now, if that's a hardship for you, paying the $50, I want you to pull me aside, say, Pastor John, we would like our child to go to camp, but we're struggling with the $50. You just come to me and I'll take care of it. I have plenty of people here in the congregation that help me out with things like that. So if you do, don't let that prevent you from going. And it's a great Pastor Amy, the assistant pastor here, is preaching up at Hope Church right now. And they're having a special speaker there today. But her and I both donate or give a week of the summer ourselves in counselors at camp. So we go there each year, we enjoy it, and it's a very nice place to send your children. We're looking for help with our Vacation Bible School. Debbie is over here on my left, and there's a sign-up poster board downstairs, and you can help and you can sign up for that. And there's people come into the church through Vacation Bible School. I know Naima did. Her children came to Vacation Bible School here. They were looking for a church, and she said, where'd you like to go? And she said, we'd like to go to Atonement Church because they came here for Vacation Bible School. So looking for volunteers, looking for help, looking for people, and you can get all the information downstairs or from here or from Debbie itself. We're also working on a summer retreat. That's the blue insert that's in your bulletin today. If you would be interested in that, please sign up. We have a number of people signed up for that already. There's a limited amount of people that can go. And I want to say you, Naima, signed up, but your daughters may go too. It's for young people and for children as well. So you want to think about that and pray about that. So we're going to go into the service of baptism. I'll be reading from a book, and there'll also be things on the screens that you will be able to follow along with. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated in the Christ Holy Church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through the water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift offered to us without price. I present Kaylee Nicole for baptism. You come up here. And anybody that's going to be standing up here with her will come up. I'm going to address the question to you to begin with, and then we'll address the congregation. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world and repent of your sin. If so, answer, I do. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, answer, I do. Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, answer, I do. And you, as sponsors, will you nurture Kaylee in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example that she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, to profess her faith openly, and to lead a Christian life? If so, answer, I will. To the congregation, I ask you this. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ?
Yeah.
Will you nurture one another in the Christian faith and include this person now before you in your care? You will help. Good news. And live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. Let us join together in professing the Christian faith as contained in the scriptures of the Old and New Testaments. Do you believe in God the Father? Creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ?
I believe in
Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day He rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit?
I believe
in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. The water that we use here at Atonement Church and at the branch worship is from the Jordan River. And what makes that special is that Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River. So the water that we use here is from the Jordan River, which I will see this week because I'm going there. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Eternal Father, when nothing else existed but chaos, you swept across the dark waters and brought forth light. In the days of Noah, you saved those on the ark through water. After the flood, you set in the clouds a rainbow. When you saw your people as slaves in Egypt, you led them to freedom through the sea. Their children you brought through the Jordan to the land which you promised. Sing to the Lord, all the earth, tell of God's mercies each day. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb. He was baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. Declare his work to the nations, his glory among all the people. Pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in his final victory. All praise to you, eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen. Kaylee Nicole, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit work within you, that being born of the water and the Spirit, you may live to be a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen. It's our joy to welcome our new sister in Christ. Through baptism, you are incorporated by the Holy Spirit in God's new creation and made to share in Christ's royal priesthood. We are all one in Christ Jesus. With joy and thanksgiving, we welcome you as a member of the household family of Christ. Members of the household of God, I commend this person to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase her faith, confirm her hope, and perfect her in love. We give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in the body of Christ and in this congregation, the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant faithfully to participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, and our service, that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. And the God of all grace, Kaylee, who has called us into eternal glory in Christ, establish you and strengthen you by the power of the Holy Spirit, that you may live in grace and peace. To the congregation, members of the household of faith, I commend to you your love and care of this child, whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that this child may grow in the knowledge of love of God through Jesus Christ, our Savior? With God's help, we so order our lives after the example of Christ, that this child, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for this baptism of this child. May she leave this place today, going in your grace and glory, and live a Christian life and bring honor and glory to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, man. Father God, we thank you for this day. We thank you, Lord, for blessing us, your people. And Father, now as we receive our offering, may we receive it into your kingdom, and that it will be used to honor you, O God, that it will be used to glorify you. For I pray it in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Casting aside every sin and every weight.
Today's Bible lesson comes from the book of Acts, chapter 4, verse 12. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. This is God's word for God's people. Thanks be to God.
Last week we talked about taking the gospel around the world and talking about the importance of that, and we say, how can we do that? How can we, a little church in Claymont, Delaware, across from the Claymont Steak Shop, have an influence like that around the world? Well, what we do is we have this is being recorded right now, and tomorrow it's put on our website so people can go watch this. They can see what's happening here on a Sunday morning. We got an email from someone from New Zealand last week that there's a group of people in New Zealand that watch this, and they like the branch, they like what's going on here. So that's taking the word of God and taking it around the world, right?
Amen.
Amen. So we want to welcome the people from New Zealand here to this time of worship. One day this week I was sitting in my office and the doors were closed, and I felt the necessary to go out into the welcome center, and of course I wasn't sure why, and I went out, and there was a woman standing there, a young woman, and I asked her if I could be of any help, and she said no. I said, do you want to talk to anybody? She said no. She said, I just want to be here. I just want to come inside of this church building and just be here, and just be here for a while. Now, we find that. We have people that are coming in our church building, or they're driving by, and for some reason, they'll pull in here or walk in off of the street because they know that there's something pulling them in there, and the something is the Holy Spirit. It's Almighty God through the Holy Spirit calling people into this place, and good things are happening here. I had a lady call me this week, and her husband lived here in Claymont, and she lived in New Jersey. And her family lived in Pennsylvania. They weren't separated like we would think of a couple being separated, but he had some medical issues, he had some medical problems, he had some emotional problems. There was a lot of things going on in this man's life, and he lived in a group home in this community. He didn't have a car, so he would walk by the church here, and he'd walk by, and I'd see him outside, and I'd talk to him, and we'd talk back and forth, and he started to come to church here. And he came, he'd always sit the same place, and he loved coming here to Atonement Church. He got sicker, and he called me one day, he said, Pastor John, I just have a few days to live. And he said, I wanted you to know that. So he did pass away, and I did his funeral. His wife called me and said that Douglas wanted me to do his funeral, which is a real honor for us to do a baptism, so a real honor for us to do. I mean, this is good God things going on here. So she called me this week. This woman called me this week, and she said, Pastor John, I've only met her twice. She said, Pastor John, she said, I want to send you some money to use whatever you want to use for in the church. Anything that you want to use it for, you use it. She said, it's not a lot of money, but I'm going to send it to you. So I said, okay. She said, I'm going to send you $1,500. And I thought, well, that's good. That's a good amount of money. So she said, I said, you know, this is such a blessing that you're doing this. And I said, the reason is because I'm trying to get money together to send some of our people here to go to AV school, to technician school, so they can learn the tricks and the trade of the sound systems that we have here. And I said, I needed money to do that, and we didn't have it in the budget. And I said, there's a seminar up at LCBC in Lancaster, Pennsylvania, Lancaster County, and I want to go there and I want to send a group of people there. So as I'm talking to her, I'm beginning to become very emotional. And if you've been here 2 weeks in a row, you know that I cry easily. So I was on the phone talking to Linda and I started to cry. And I said, Linda, I'm sorry, but I said, what you're saying is so timely. God is working in such a great way here. I had these financial situations that I needed to take care of, and I didn't know where I was going to get the money. And I said, and then you called, and then you gave me this money. And she said, well, Pastor John, she said, well, then I'll send you $2,000. So then I'm thinking, you know, if I keep crying, I'm going to get more money out of this. But that really happened. And these things happen here. Praise the Lord. Right now, I'll tell you right now, things are happening at our daughter church. Wayne's up there praying. We had Wayne here a couple weeks ago. There was 50 people in line for prayer. But we're having a series right now and asking big questions. And the big question today is Jesus the only way to get to heaven? That's the big question. And people ask this question. I don't know if I should admit this, and I know this is being taped, and I know that's on YouTube now, but I'm in this so far here, I got to continue on. But when I'm getting dressed in the morning, and I'm doing things in my apartment, I'm getting ready for all this, I like to watch Imus in the morning. You ever watch Don Imus? Now, there's things that I can't watch on there because they get a little out of bounds, so I have to switch to another channel and watch something else. But I like to watch his guests. There's authors on there. There's politicians on there. And one of the reasons that I was drawn to his show in the first place is because my first cousin, Harriet, used to be married to him. And she brought him to the family reunion. I wrote in my notes, I said, I met him one time, and that's a lie. I never met him. But he was there, I saw him, and he was right there eating with us and everything. So, but anyhow, on his show, and this is why I'm talking about this, on his show, he will interview, like, clergy people. He'll interview priests. He'll interview authors of religious books. He interviews these people. And he does this every time. He will say to them, I believe that there's more than one way to get to heaven. What do you think? And almost every time their response is, yeah, I think there's more than one way to get to heaven. I think that's possible. And I'm shouting at the television. I'm saying, you're wrong. There's only one way to get to heaven, and that's through Jesus Christ. So I'm yelling at the TV. The TV doesn't say anything back to me, but they're having this conversation on TV that I'm really not buying into, because here's what happens. In our congregation here, we have a couple of hundred people on a Sunday morning, around 300. Don Imus reaches 10 million. See, and I can hear people saying, well, if that clergy person is saying there's more than one way to get to heaven, there must be. If Don Imus thinks there's more than one way to get to heaven, that must be right. But it's not right. It's wrong. According to the Word of God that we study, that we read, that we believe in, it's wrong. So it's not true. And I know people would say, well, preacher, aren't you being a little bit narrow-minded? I ask myself that question. Aren't you being narrow-minded on this subject? And I say to myself, yeah, I am. But here's what I read. And I read this in the Bible one day. In Matthew 7:13, Jesus says this, enter through the narrow gate. See the narrow? Enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction. See, there's a broad road and there's a narrow road. We're on the narrow road in life. We are on the road that Jesus wants us to be on. And I get upset because what we're dealing with here is eternal life. What we're dealing with here is the matter of life and death. If I'm giving the wrong message here on a Sunday morning, it's serious stuff. This isn't something that we're just talking about to take lightly. It can be very, very serious. So the broad road is to say that there are several roads to Jesus. That's the broad road. The narrow road, and that's where the majority of the people are, incidentally, but the narrow road is the true road. And if we're walking with Jesus, we're walking on a narrow road. That's where we're at. Jesus plainly tells us in our scripture today that there's only one way to the Father, and that's through him. John 14:6 says this, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now, you Bible scholars here, you people that make notes, that's a Bible verse that you want to write down and keep. Because if people know that you're a Christian, if people know that you're born again, if people know that you go to worship and go to church, they may ask you these big questions. Is there more than one way to get to Jesus? And you can say no. And here's how you back it up. Now see, we have a little bit of a problem here today, and this is what a little bit of the problem is that when I typed out my message today, I normally do it in space and a half. This week, it's one. So there's a lot more written here than what we have time for. See? If you have a Bible along, if you turn to Genesis chapter 11, it's the first book of the Bible, Genesis chapter 11, 1 through 11, and this is what it says. Now the whole world, this is back when the world was first created, the whole world had one language and common speech. Everybody spoke the same language. There wasn't languages like we have today. So they said to each other, "Come, let's make bricks and bake them thoroughly." And they used brick instead of stone and tar for mortar. Then they said, "Come, let us build ourselves a city with a tower that reaches to the heavens, so that we may make a name for ourselves and not be scattered over the face of the earth." You see, what the people wanted to do is they wanted to get to heaven. They knew that there was somebody in heaven. They knew that there was a God in heaven. They knew that there was a creation in heaven, but they didn't want to go to God in the proper channels. They didn't want to take the route that they needed to go through. They wanted to build a city, and they wanted to build a tower of their own to get into heavens. And this is what they said, that they are building this tower that reaches into heaven so that we may make a name for ourselves. You know what that's called? It's called pride. If we want to make a name for ourselves, that's called pride. It's being boastful. It's being prideful. And God has nothing to do with that. The only way, we're sinners here. I'm a sinner. And I'll admit that. I'll confess that to you. But I also have a Savior. And Jesus is the Savior. I also confess that to you. They wanted to make a name for themselves, and they didn't want to be scattered over the face of the earth. That's what they didn't want to do. They wanted to get to heaven, they wanted to make a name for themselves, and they didn't want to be scattered over the face of the earth. But the Lord came down to see the city and the tower that the men were building. I love that thought. I love that thought of the Lord coming down and walking around earth and watching these people working, and they're toiling, and they have the engineers out, and they have all these people out there, and the Lord is down here on earth watching this all take place, and somebody's saying, "Who's that? I don't ever recognize that person. Who's that?" They say, "Never mind. We're building a tower here. We want to get into the heavens. Don't worry about that person." But the Lord is walking around. The Lord said, "If as one people speaking the same language they have begun to do this, then nothing they plan to do will be impossible for them." See that? People have great minds. People have great abilities. People have great talents. We really, really do. So verse 7 says, "Come, let us." See that plural? "Let us go down and confuse their language so that they will not understand each other." So who's us? Well, it's the Trinity. God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. They all came down to earth, and they confused their language. So the Lord scattered them from their all the earth, and they stopped building the city. The very thing that they feared came upon them. The very thing they feared of being spread around the world came upon them, because that's exactly what God did. The people couldn't communicate with each other anymore. They had to teach each other their language of whatever tongue that would be. They had to learn that. If they were cooking, or they were making bricks, or they were making whatever, and they would look around and they would say, "Bring me the bricks." They wouldn't know what they're saying. "Bring me the mortar." They wouldn't know what they're saying. They go home to their wife or their husbands or their kids, and nobody could understand each other because God confused their language, and then he spread them all over the earth. Now, if we turn to Acts chapter 3, that's in the New Testament, that's towards the back of the Bible, and we go Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts. The reason it's called the Acts is because it's the Acts of the Apostles. It's the very first church. And here we see about a man that was by the gate called Beautiful. And he was there every day. He was a, Acts 3, he was a, by the temple gate called Beautiful, People put him there every day to beg for money because he couldn't work. He was crippled. He never walked. When he saw Peter and John walking by them, he said, ask them for money. When they asked him for money, Peter looked at him and said, look at us. So the man gave them attention, expecting to get something from them. Then Peter said, silver or gold I do not have, but what I have I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. You see, what the disciples there did was they had healed that man through the name of Jesus Christ. They didn't have money to give them. They didn't have gold to give him. They didn't have silver to give him. But what they gave him was Jesus Christ. And taking him by the right hand, he helped him up, and instantly the man's feet and ankles became strong. This man had not walked for 40 years. He's never walked in his life. And now, because he heard the name of Jesus, his ankles began to get strong. And he got stronger, and then he stood up, and he began to walk. He had a hold of Peter's hand. He had a hold of John's hand. They were walking along with him because he had never walked before. And they were walking along, and he was walking towards the temple of all places. That's really cool. And they were walking along, and then this man started to run. He thought, well, I don't have to walk. I can start to run. So he began to run, and as he was running, he was praising God. He said, thank you, Jesus, for this healing. All because they introduced this man to Jesus Christ. And the people there began to recognize him as this man that sat begging at the gate called Beautiful, and they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened. While the beggar held on to Peter and John, all the people were astonished and came running to them in the place called Solomon's Colonnade. What they did that day to that man was called an act of kindness. We do acts of kindness here all throughout the week. People come in need of prayer. People come in here in need of food. People come in here for different kinds of needs, and we supply the needs the best that we can. And why do we do acts of kindness? Why do we do it here? Why do you people do acts of kindness? We do acts of kindness because as Christians, we're called to do acts of kindness. And you say, well, I don't have a lot of money, preacher. I can't help a lot of people out. I can't help this person out. I can't help that person out. And Jesus said that if you're in that position in life, in Matthew 10:42, Jesus says, if anyone gives a cup of cold water to one of these little ones because he is my disciple, I tell you the truth, he will certainly not lose his reward. You see, an act of kindness, all it has to be is to give somebody a cup of cold water, a bottle of cold water. You see somebody toiling, you see somebody in the heat, you see somebody that needs a touch of some kind, you give them a bottle of water. We did that one time out front here. We gave out hundreds of bottles of water as people would drive by the church and they would be hot in their cars. They just came home from work. They're parked at the red light out here and they're frustrated, and somebody comes over to the car and gives them a bottle of cold water. And it's a thrill to see people's reaction. Not everybody took water. You think your preacher would? Because Peter and John did this act of kindness to this man, they ended up in prison. You can do an act of kindness sometimes and it puts you in a dire strait. But this also gave Peter and John an opportunity while they were in jail to talk about Jesus Christ. It gave them an opportunity, took teaching moments for every moment they had to tell other people about Jesus. We read in chapter 4 how Peter filled with the Holy Ghost. And he began to preach to people. He said, rulers and elders of the people, if we're being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to this cripple and are asked how he was healed, then know this, all you people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you have crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. They're talking about Jesus. He is the stone you builders rejected, which has become the capstone or the cornerstone. And then the verse that we read today, salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. Because of this act, this man being born crippled, and Peter and John showing the act of kindness, Peter was able to open up the door for many people to hear that salvation is found in no one else. No one else but Jesus Christ. I want to take a moment here, just a quick moment, and tell you that I will not be here next week because I'm going to Israel for 11 days. And Pastor Amy will be covering for me in emergencies. If any of you have an emergency, you need to talk to the pastor, you call the office or call Pastor Amy. That's the 23rd. Then when you come back here on the 30th and bring people with you, come back here on March the 30th. We have one worship service at 10 o'clock downstairs. We have the traditional worship gets together, and we have the branch contemporary worship get together. So that's 2 weeks from today at 10 o'clock. We'll meet downstairs. We'll do a one call. We'll give you a call on the phone to remind you that there's one service. So be expecting that call on the Friday before the Sunday. I'm going to call you. I'm going to have Pastor Amy call you. And she's going to talk to you and tell you about the worship. You want to come early because the parking lot's going to be filled up. You want to come early because the seats get filled up fast. You can sit in the overflow area, but the better seats are down in the sanctuary. But as I think about our Bible reading today, as I think about our lesson today, I think that I'm going to be right there. I'm going to be walking where Jesus walked. I'm going to be walking where God walked because I believe that Jesus is God, see? I'm going to be in those places. I'm going to be by this pool that this man was by the gate, beautiful gate. I'm going to be right there. It's exciting. And I want to bring back this information and use it for ministry. But in closing, let's go back to the big question. Is Jesus the only way to get to heaven? And why is Jesus the only way to God? Because if he was not the only way to God, all his suffering and all his dying would be in vain. The whole plan of salvation would be a hoax. The whole plan of salvation would all be in vain. But you see, Jesus is real. Jesus is not a hoax. And Jesus is alive today. And you say, preacher, how can you be so sure about that? The reason I'm sure is I just talked to him. I was down in my office and I just talked to Jesus. And through the Spirit, he's talking to me. I'm going to leave you with this. It's on the screen. No matter what anyone else may say or think, Jesus is the only way to God. Don't take my word for it. Take God's word for it, because it's the truth. And let us pray. Father God, I thank you for this baptism today. First of all, it's just a joy to do the baptism for little Kaylee. I thank you, Lord, that we were able to gather together and hear the beautiful music of the band, and they sounded really awesome today. I thank you, Lord, for the Bible, the teaching that you've given us. I thank you, Lord, for the visitors that are here today and for the family and friends that are here today. And I just thank you, Lord, for all the good things, for all the fruit that this congregation of people is bearing. So I thank you for that. So send us on our way, O God, and lead us out. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I pray, amen and amen.
Before we leave, let's sing one more song. If you guys are able, would you stay with us? And, you know, we're all part of God's kingdom. We are the children of the King. And in our house, in his house, I think he likes to see us excited and dancing and clapping our hands and all that stuff. And how about if you try it today? Let's just try clapping our hands. Let's just sing joyfully. Okay? Okay.
You to heal our land, Father, let revival start in us. Every heart will know your kingdom.
Don't leave this room until you pray that prayer of salvation. It's an easy prayer. It's just you cry out to God and ask Him to forgive you and to be your Savior. Don't leave this room, okay, before you make that prayer. Go knowing that you're loved and you're wanted and you're needed in this place. Go in God's peace. Amen?
To fly, to fly.